did this concept mapping exercise. We got this, what to us was, I don't guess, maybe surprising isn't the right word, but illuminating result. And I haven't, so I've wanted to address this issue, obviously, in my class, and I haven't actually done it in my case by continuing using the concept mapping in class, although I think that would be something useful to incorporate. The direction I've gone is to realize that I need to spend time in class helping students make those nuanced connections. I can do some of it in my office hours, but I'm only going to see a fraction of the students there. And I recognize that when you give lecture, or often when you read in the textbook, in a sense, you're giving them that list. I'm giving them information. I'm giving defining terms. I would do a few example problems, but I was pretty limited in class in the time that I could really make visible my thought process, for example, for attacking a problem. And so the way that I've been going about this is by gradually moving toward flipping my classroom, this idea that I put at least a fraction, maybe a third to a half of the lecture material in a video form that the students watch before they come to class, so that some of that just transfer of information from me to them is happening at home, because I don't really have to be there for that to happen. And that what we spend class time doing then are some specific examples and working through a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. The same problems that I would have given them to them as suggested problems, and they would have kind of struggled with on their own, but now we can do them in class. They might start a problem, work on it with a neighbor, or have me walk through, well, how would we start this problem? And my sort of anecdotal experience with this so far has been that it creates a much more interactive classroom environment. And I feel like I have so much more time to get across some of these connections that I just never felt that I could find time for in the lecture.
Incorporate concept maps into my course. What I've done is organize my entire course using a concept map, and I build the connections between concepts with each class meeting. So I'll make my knowledge structure evident to students in that way. So we'll talk about a concept one class, the next class talk about something that they might not see the connection between, but by the end of the class, we will make that connection and build the map incrementally as we go through the semester. And I think that has helped with big picture understanding. The students comment a lot about how they really understand the big picture in ways that they didn't in high school. And a lot of open-ended problem solving too. I haven't totally flipped my classroom, but cut a lot of material so that I can incorporate active learning, group work, open-ended problems and assignments in class that and guide students through how to approach and how to attack those problems. So every day we build this concept map. So I start the class with, here's a big map. It may look intimidating right now, but by the end of the semester, we are going to understand how all these things are connected. So at the beginning of every session, we look at the map, what we've learned so far, and then add a connection where we're going. And for me, at least, that helps me organize myself, but I think it also helps the students see, yeah, this is what the course is about. It's a unified theme, a unified unified concepts, and these are how they all fit together. Yeah, the whole course is built around this concept map, so it's in the syllabus, it's in almost every PowerPoint presentation that I use. It's an integral part of the course. I don't know if they would use that particular big picture map, but I encourage them to make their own maps, and I think that's what they use to study for the final exam. And I'll be very explicit about to study these concepts, make a map using these nodes, and just being very explicit about exactly the connections that I'm hoping that they make has really encouraged them to actually make these maps on their own.
Having students work on open-ended problems and being able to really figure out those sorts of problems is critical to an understanding of genetics. And I'm sure that's true in many other areas as well. And it depends to some extent on the problem, I guess, but what it does is the student has to take information that they've learned, say, about how alleles segregate, but they have to actually apply it to a situation that's different from what they've ever seen before. And so these are problems, and they'll have this on an exam as well, that's not exactly like any other problem they've ever seen. And all the parts will be something that they've learned about, but they have to be able to recognize that, oh, if this happens, then that is going to have this effect, and I can test it by doing this. Mm-hmm. And so the problem itself forces them to connect those ideas together. Mm-hmm. And so doing a problem that involves, say, a translocation between two chromosomes and how that would affect how genes segregate is much more powerful than saying, here's what a translocation is. Mm-hmm. And means, I think, that they'll remember it going forward, and hopefully, you know, even if they don't remember exactly what a translocation is, or exactly, they might remember what a translocation is, but even if they don't remember exactly what it does, they can sit down and figure it out later. So the advantage of doing these kinds of problems in class rather than just assigning them for them to do on their own, well, there are several advantages. So I think the main one is that I can make visible to them the type of the way I attack a problem. So how do I get started? Which parts of the problems do I pay attention to? Mm-hmm. These are all word problems, right? And we remember being terrified by word problems when you were like seven in elementary school. And part of it is because there's a lot of information in there, and you have to know how to zoom in on the mm-hmm. parts that are really important. And I think that students can spend an awful lot of time spinning their wheels trying to work on a problem like this without ever really accomplishing anything when they're working on their own. But I can, in class, I can make some of that visible or kind of get them started, or they can work with a partner and maybe the person next to them has an idea how to get started and they can kind of work it out together.
Something that I've discovered doing these open-ended problems in class is I've discovered misconceptions that they have that I never would have thought of before. Like I do a similar activity where I ask them to draw meiosis and there were huge problems just getting started. And I realized that they had the very first step was something, there was a huge roadblock there. And I don't think I would have realized it if I wasn't doing that in class. And
it has made the class time much more interactive than it was mm-hmm. before. So I noticed a huge difference in how willing students were just to simply volunteer an idea during class when we would start working on a problem. I did some problem solving in class before, and I would often feel like, you know, I had just presented the material that they needed for the project or for the problem, and then immediately I'd put up the problem. They hadn't had time to think about the information or to really incorporate it yet. But that was really the only way to do it. It didn't make a lot of sense to give all the information and then the next class period come back with a problem that was unrelated to what I was talking about that day. So what happened when I flipped the classroom is they've had at least the time they've been sleeping, depending on when they watch the videos, to think about the material that I presented. And they seemed much more able to start volunteering information. And there is, in a classroom, I think, a real dynamic that once a few students start getting willing to talk, then others start getting willing to talk, and it kind of plays on itself. And so for me, I think that was one of the biggest changes, was just feeling that the classroom became much more mm-hmm. dynamic. And I think they started to realize something I always tell them, which is that if you have a question about something, I can guarantee you someone else in this class has the same question, but they haven't raised their hand to ask it. And I think, again, this little added confidence from having seen the material already when they came really helps with that mm-hmm. part of the course.
So I've looked at withdrawal rates before I did the active learning, open-ended problem solving, and after. And for my course, at least, it was cut in half. Which is, for our university, I think, a big deal. And the number of E-grades also was cut in half. Yeah, it was pretty unbelievable, the difference in just having that active learning environment, and it was worth their time to come to class. So they did. And yeah, the withdrawal rate was cut in half.